If you remember what I did yesterday, I was in the dynamical proof of the fact that square root of 2 is an irrational number. And the proof was not totally finished yet, almost but not totally, so I will start the course of today by finishing this proof and reminding you the situation we reached yesterday. Dynamical proof of irrationality. Of square root of 2. And if you remember, we introduced yesterday a matrix, a square matrix, 2 times 2, with the following coefficients. So this matrix is capital A equals, so correct me if I make a mistake here, it was -1, -1, 2 here, correct? And 1 here, is it good? So this is the matrix we considered yesterday. And we noticed something very special about this matrix, the fact that there exists what I called yesterday a special vector. I called it V1. And this vector is the vector of coordinates square root of 2, 1. And I call that a special vector. So let me remind you in which sense this vector is special. It is special because when you multiply the matrix A by V1, that is, if you apply the transformation to the vector V1, the result is something which is not complicated. It is just a vector which is a multiple of V1, and the number of multiplication is square root of 2 minus 1, which multiply V1. So this is the important relation here. So this is what we established more or less yesterday. Okay. So in this sense, this vector is special. You should keep in mind that in general, when you multiply a vector by a matrix, there is no reason a priori for the image under this transformation is in the same direction that V1 in general. But this is why this vector is so special. So let me add a little remark to this equation here, which is almost immediate, straightforward computation. If you consider another vector, so let me call it W, which is collinear to V1. So it means that there exists alpha in R. So I consider a non-zero vector. So alpha is a non-zero real number such that W equals alpha V1. So we have a vector V1 which is special, and now I consider a multiple of this vector V1, and I call W the result. Let me do the following computation. What is the image of the transformation A applied to W? So you compute A multiplied by W, simply. I want to understand the result of this computation. So what it is? It is A multiplied by, so I use dot or multiplication sign. It's the same operation. Multiplied by W, which is alpha V1. And you know that if you multiply a matrix by a vector with a multiplication by a number here, you can put away the number alpha and you obtain alpha multiplied by AV1. Now this is immediate computation. So what do you get at the end? You get that, remember that AV1 satisfies this special property here, so we can go ahead in the equalities, you obtain alpha multiplied by AV1, which is nothing but square root of 2 minus 1 times V1. And one again, the alpha, you can put it here. This is square root of 2 multiplied by alpha v1. That is square root of 2 minus 1 multiplied by w. This is extremely easy, of course, nothing hard here. So what we get is that a multiplied by w is equal by 2, sorry, square root of 2 minus 1 w. So this is what we get by this elementary computation. So what is the conclusion of this computation? The conclusion is if v1 is special, then w is special also, is as well special. Okay? W is special with the same number square root of 2 minus 1. So w is special. Okay, so every multiple of v1 is also a special vector for A. So this is a simple remark. So why do I make this remark here? Because it will help me in finishing the proof of the irrationality of square root of 2. So now let's do this proof. So proof of rationality. The square root of 2 is irrational. Okay, so let's do as usual. Let's suppose that square root of 2 is rational and try to reach a contradiction. So assume square root of 2 rational. That is, square root of 2 equals p divided by q, where the numbers pq are integers and q not zero. And p and q are integers, positive integers. Okay, we assume that. Okay, if it is the case, look to the vector v1. So v1 is this special vector we had yesterday. Look to this vector. So this vector is equal to p divided by q, because I assumed that square root of 2 is p divided by q, and the second coordinate is 1. Okay, so this is just the fact that I have assumed that square root of 2 is rational. But now, if you multiply this vector by q, you obtain a vector w, which is q v1, and whose coordinates are p and q. This vector is very interesting for two reasons. First reason, w is special. This is what I proved here. When I multiply v1 by a number alpha, the result w is special. So here, this vector w is special, first fact. Second fact, important, the coordinates of w are integers, positive integers. So coordinates, integers. Okay, so this vector is, how can I call it? Very special, for this reason. Okay, so let me draw a little picture now. So I consider the classical system of coordinates. So the vector v1, if you remember, its coordinates are square root of 2, which is 1.4 or something, and 1 for the ordinate. So v1 is like that. So let me draw the line, which is directed by the vector v1. And let me insist of v1. So v1 is this vector here. And the vector w is the same vector than v1, but multiplied by p. So I will now draw the vector w, which will be parallel but longer than v1. So w is somewhere here. Am I clear? So this is the picture we get from these simple remarks. Okay, two vectors, collinear, and moreover, W is special and with integer coordinates. So now I want to understand the orbit. What is the behavior of the orbit of W under the action of A? The action of A. You remember what I called an orbit yesterday? So I start with a point, and I multiply by A, the matrix A, and again, and again, and again. So it gives you a sequence of points, and I want to understand what's happening to this sequence of points. The computation is easy. A raised to the power n multiplied by V1 is nothing but this number square root of 2 minus 1 raised to V1 multiplied by V1. So we have this formula. Oh, sorry, not V1, W. I am interested in W now. So here you place V1 by W. Is it clear? So let me give a name to these vectors or points. Let me call, we let Wn equals A raised to n times W. Question for you. What's happening to this sequence of points? Where does it go? So the fact is that 0 is smaller than this number, of course, but this one is smaller than 1. The order of magnitude of this number is something like 0.4. Agree? So if this number is more, strictly smaller than 1, it means that square root of 2 minus 1 raised to n goes to 0 when n goes to infinity. So these numbers shrinks. They get smaller and smaller and smaller, which means that the sequence of points here, which starts in W, then you have W1 here, whatever, so W equals W1, W2, W3. So the dynamic of this sequence of points is to be attracted by zero. So the sequence Wn is attracted by zero, by the origin. You see what I mean by attracted? I mean that the limit of this sequence of points is the origin. Okay. I claim that there is a problem with that. There is a contradiction. So what is the contradiction here? I claim that this is not possible. So if I am right, if this is not possible, everything here is false, which means that the hypothesis here is false. Correct? So why is there a problem here? What is the problem? So the contradiction is here. So remember that the coordinates of Wn are positive integers. Okay? Is it clear for everybody? No. So if you cannot have at the same time being a sequence of points whose coordinates are positive integers and going to zero. So there is a contradiction. There is a contradiction. So this contradiction, of course, finishes the proof. The assumption I have made here is impossible. So square root of 2 is not, from this dynamical approach, cannot be a rational number. So this is what I call the dynamical proof of irrationality of square root of 2. Dynamical because we observe the behavior of a dynamical system, that is the action of the matrix A, and again and again and again, to a special sequence of points, and which reach to an impossibility. You would have a sequence of integer points which go to zero, which is absolutely impossible. It is clear? The key point of the proof is somewhere here, the existence of the special vector v1, and the fact that if square root of 2 was rational, you would have a special vector with integer coordinates. And moreover, the fact that the number square root of 2 minus 1, as you said, is smaller than 1. Clear? So there is now an immediate generalization of this result. Okay, I'm very happy I have been able to prove with a dynamical system that square root of 2 is irrational. So, is this method general or not? Now, if I want to consider, what can we say? On square root of n, for n an integer bigger than 2. Can we prove something of the same type of result for a general number like that? You see the point? Okay, so let's go slowly and start with the easy case. You have at least two possibilities. So first possibility, square root of n is an integer. It is possible. For example, if n equals 16, if I am correct, square root of n is 4. So it is possible to be an integer. In that case, you have nothing to say. Okay, it is an integer. You stop, you have a drink, perfect. But what is interesting now is the second possibility. What does it say? The second possibility, well, is that precisely square root of n is not an integer, which happens very often. Square root of 3, square root of 5, square root of 6, 7, and so on, right? So what can we say in that case? So the proposition, the general proposition, is that in that case, if n is bigger or equal than 2, and square root of n is not an integer, then square root of n is irrational. That's the general result you should keep in mind. You have a very good case. Square root of n is an integer, and a very bad case. Nothing in the middle. Okay? So I will give you the hint of a possible proof of this result via this method, via the dynamical approach. So idea for a dynamical proof of this proposition. So So when I say an idea, it means that I'm not going to do all the details on the blackboard. You will have to do the details by yourself, but they are not difficult at all. What I call a dynamical proof is exactly what we did here. We are going to consider a dynamical system given by a matrix and try to reach the same time, the same type of impossibility as we did for square root of 2. So first thing, we have to consider a good matrix. It will not be this one. This one, of course, is good because the 2 here is appropriate for square root of 2. So it cannot be this one. We have to change. So let me consider another matrix. So remember that square root of n is not an integer. So it's a positive real number. And as you know, a positive real number which is not an integer has, how do you call that, integer part. You see what I mean? The bigger integer, smaller than square root of n. So square root of n has what we call an integer part. Do you understand me when I say that? Yes, no, yes? Cool. So let me give a notation for that. It depends on the books. Some books have some notation. Some other books have some other notations. So let me denote it by this notation here, bracket square root of n. Okay? And I will call k this number. So it is the biggest integer smaller than square root of n. Correct? So with this number, I will build another matrix. So now we consider another A. Another A appropriate to the situation, which is the following. A equals the following matrix. Instead of -1, -1 there, we are going here to write minus k. Okay? Instead of 2 in the matrix A there, here I write n. Okay? And here, I don't remember, but I will read my notes. I guess it's 1 as well. Yeah, it is 1. Okay, so the same type of matrix, which is, of course, adapted to the number square root of n. So what I claim is that we can reproduce the proof that we did there exactly in the same way. So what I'm going to do now, and then I stop with that and I will let you finish, is to convince you that for the matrix A there is a special vector V1 exactly as we had here. So claim, and I'm going to prove it. V1, which is the vector square root of n1, is a special vector. So I will write the proof of that. So what does it mean? It means that when I multiply A, the matrix A, and this vector, I obtain a new vector W, which is a multiple of this one, which is collinear to this one. So let me do the computation. So we compute A multiplied by the vector V1. So now the matrix A is this one. Okay, so I write it minus k n 1 minus k multiplied by the vector v1, which is this one, square root of n and minus 1. Okay, So let me do this computation. I obtain the vector W, which is the following: minus k square root of n plus n and square root of n minus k. And we do now the same trick we did yesterday with the matrix A. Here, on the first row, for the first component of this vector, I factor out square root of n. So this one is equal to square root of n multiplied by minus k plus square root of n. And the second one, I don't change. Clear? So it's a very simple computation. So what do I get here? I get the fact that if you read the computation here, the result is the following: A multiplied by V1 equals, let me read again, equals square root of n minus k multiplied by V1. Times V1. Am I clear? So you recognize everything. For square root of 2, we had there square root of 2 instead of square root of n. It is exactly the same thing. And we do the same remark. You notice that this number square root of n minus k is positive and smaller than 1. Why is it so? Why is the case? Well, obvious. Square root of n is bigger than k because k is the integer part. So it is positive. And moreover, k is the biggest integer smaller than square root of n. So it exactly means that the difference is smaller than 1. That's it. So this is the definition of the number integer part. Okay? So we have exactly the same situation that we had for square root of 2. So the proof ends in exactly the same way. So I leave you the exercise, finish the proof. Finish the proof, the dynamical proof. The dynamical proof of irrationality of square root of n. And now you should know how to finish, if you understood what we did for square root of 2. It is exactly the same trick. This orbit of a point with integer coordinates being attracted by zero. The same kind of contradiction. Okay, so there is now another generalization of the initial result. So we prove that square root of n is integer or irrational. This result now extends to a very important result of number theory, which is the following one. I will write the statement, and you have to tell me if the statement is clear, the words of the statement is clear or not for you, or if you need explanation to part of the statement. So this is a theorem, which is important in number theory. And this theorem says the following thing. Consider a monic polynomial of x equals xn plus a n minus 1 x n minus 1 plus a n minus 2 x n minus 2 plus a0, where a and the coefficients a n minus 1, a n minus 2 until a0 belong to z. That is, are integers. Everybody knows the word polynomial. You have to tell me, is it clear for you or not? No question? Okay. So the word monic, maybe. The word monic is not totally universal. The word monic means that the first coefficient here is equal to 1. This is what it means. Okay. So this is, you consider such a polynomial. Then, the root alpha of this polynomial, of such a polynomial, so you, everybody understand what is the root of a polynomial? It is a number alpha such that, so that is p applied to alpha equals zero. That the definition of the word root of a polynomial, okay? So, then a root alpha of such a polynomial is first an integer to or an irrational number. Same consequence. So either extremely good, an integer, or pretty bad, an irrational number. So nothing in the middle. So it's not possible to have a rational root of this polynomial if it is not an integer. So that's an important result to keep in mind. Is the statement clear? There exist many, many proofs of this result. One of them is dynamical. I won't write it here because it would be too long for the context of this course, but I would like you to keep this in mind and behind, or possibly to do your research by yourself on Wikipedia or wherever, or in books. The proof is not, there are several proofs and none of them is difficult. So you can read it and you need nothing. But there is a dynamical proof with matrix, as we did here, but instead of matrix with two lines and two columns, you would need matrix with n lines and n columns, n being the degree of the polynomial here. So it's a little more complicated. But the spirit is exactly the same. You need a special vector, and you want to understand the orbit of this special vector. Okay, so far so good for the generalization. Okay, so now, so this was the generalization of the dynamical proof of square root of 2. In a moment, I will come back on this proof, of this dynamical proof, and I will show that this proof is interesting because it tells you two things. The first one, it tells you that square root of 2 is irrational. Perfect. The second one, as we are going to see in a moment, is that it gives you a way of compute square root of 2. And we will see what we mean by computing an irrational number. But before going to this, I have to tell you the last proof of the irrationality of square root of 2, which is absolutely fantastic. I discovered it recently in a book. I didn't know that when I was myself a student, so I'm pretty happy to show this proof here. And this proof is fantastic because it is something in two lines, nothing more. And it is extremely smart. So if I am correct, it is now the fourth proof. We had geometric proof, arithmetic proof, dynamical proof, and now is the fourth proof. So D, and this is the proof of irrationality. Of square root of 2 by working in basis 3. It is very strange. It is smart, short, as you will see, but strange. So I have to explain you what I mean by working in basis 3. So, reminder. As you know, classically, when we represent an integer or a real number, we used to work with a decimal expansion of these numbers, which means that we work in basis 10. Of course, nobody obliges you to do so, and you can expand an integer in basis 3. So every integer n can be written in basis 3. So what does it mean? Am I clear here? So what does it mean? It means that you can work only by considering the as digits 0, 1, and 2. This is what it means by working in basis 3. For example, what is 7 in basis 3? How can I write 7 in basis 3? So you have to consider 3 and powers of 3. So the first power of 3 is 1, 3 to the 0. Then you have 3 itself. And then 3 square. 3 square is too big. 3 square is 9. So you have to consider only 1 and 3. So what can we do here?
21.
Sorry?
21.
Yeah, so we have 2 and 1, which mean 1 itself plus 2 times 3. 2 times 3. So let me write here this symbol, which explains that I'm working in basis 3. So that means equals to 2 times 3. So the 2 here is the 2 here, plus 1. Is it clear for everybody? So every integer can be written that way. So the digits are the numbers which appear here. They can be 0, 1, or 2. So now the fact is the following. So I give you the hint of the proof of this fact in a sentence, and I will let you check by yourself that the fact is actually true and easy, by the way. Fact. Well, it's not a fact, sorry, it's a remark or hint, indication. So, suppose, once again, suppose that square root of 2 is rational. Suppose that square root of 2 is rational. Okay? Once again, it means that square root of 2 can be written as a quotient, p divided by q, or that q square, 2 times q square equals p square. Of course, with p, q integers, and q non-zero. suppose the classical thing that we want to disprove precisely. We want to prove that this is not possible. So now you have two integers here, p and q. Write them in basis 3. And the fact is a square number what I call a square or squared number means p2, p square, right? A square number in basis 3 has its least non-zero digit. So what I mean by least is the digit which is the most on the right. When you write the number here, it would be 1 for this number. So this is what I call least. Is it clear? So when you write the number, there is a digit which is a non-zero digit, which is at the most possible right. This is what I call the least non-zero, but not 3, excuse me, digit. There is something not correct in my sentence in basis 3 here, excuse me. So let me say it again. A square number in basis 3 has its least non-zero digit equals to and I let you finish the sentence. What can it be? You have the choice. It can be zero, not zero, but it can be 1 or 2 if it is not zero. Okay? And now, same kind of sentence. Same kind of sentence. The double of a square number has its least non-zero digit in basis 3. Equals to, and I let you finish the sentence. Nothing hard here. Of course, what I have in mind that this one cannot be this one, whatever you do. It will imply that you will not have 2, which is the double of a square number, 2q square equals to p square, if these two guys do not coincide. You understand what you have to do? So check, finish the sentence, and deduce from this sentence an impossibility here. So show impossibility. Nothing hard, nothing, just a look. Very simple computation, one line, and it's enough. So that's a very nice proof, very original. As I told you before, I didn't knew this proof when I was myself a student, and I discovered it by chance in a book pretty recently. Now I have a question for you. It's not a question, it's not an exercise, it's a question. I tried a little bit, but I was not very successful. So how can I call that? Question exercise. I mean that I don't know the answer. I don't know the answer to that. But maybe something is possible. Can we do something like that? Something similar. For the other guys, square root of 3, square root of 5, and so on. Before doing this, we are going to consider a little example. which, if you understand it, it will be useful for the future of this section. So, example, consider the following matrix. As usual, I call A the matrix. And this matrix is going to be simple, a diagonal matrix with a 2 here, 0 outside of the diagonal, and the number 1 divided by 3 here. Why not? So this is a simple matrix because it is diagonal, and there is something special here. So I would like you to notice this now. 2 is a positive number, minus 1 divided by 3. I want this number to be negative. So 2 is a positive number, bigger than 1. And here, minus 1 over square is the opposite of 1 over square, which is between 0 and 1. So this is the two important properties of this matrix. So the first number is positive and bigger than 1, and the second number is negative, but it is the opposite of a small number. By small, I mean smaller than 1. Okay? Now I want to understand, can we describe the orbits of A, of the action of A. On the plane R2. Well, it is pretty easy to do so because the matrix is diagonal, so the orbits are going to be very easy to compute. So consider a first point, say, let me call it V0, which coordinates x0, y0. Okay? So I want to understand the orbit of this point. What does mean the orbit? The orbit is made of the points let me call them Vn. And what are the coordinates of these points? Of these points Vn? Well, you multiply this diagonal matrix 2 times, 3 times, 4 times, n times, which means that here you will see the number 2 raised to power n. So you will have here 2 power n multiplied by x0. And here you will have minus 1 over 3 raised to the power n, that is minus n 1 to the power n multiplied by 1/3 to the n multiplied by x0. Am I clear? So this is what you obtain. This is nothing but, I should write it here, the matrix An multiplied by V0. So I like to do the computation for diagonal matrix because they are almost immediate. So now can I draw something from this? Can I draw the orbit of a point? Let's see. Well, let me draw the classical axis of coordinates, x and y. So let me consider a point, and I pick the point in the positive quadrant, that is x0 positive and y0 positive. So here we have the initial point v0, which is this one. Okay? And now we want to see, to follow the action of this matrix acting on this point. This point is going to move right, left, middle, up, I don't know. So I would like to see where. Well, what's happening here? Vn equals 2 raised to the power n multiplied by x0 when n goes to infinity. 2n goes to infinity. So it means that the abscess of this point increase. So the points vn are going to the right. Am I correct? But now what is the behavior of the ordinate? Minus 1 n is positive, negative, positive, negative, positive, negative. So ping pong, ping pong, ping pong, ping pong, ping. Okay, stop. And now this number, 1/3 to the n. 1/3 is smaller than 1, once again. So it goes to 0, 1/3 to the n. So we have actually ping pong, ping pong, ping pong, ping pong. You see? This is the orbit of the point. So let me draw it a little more expressively. So here is V1, so V0 here. V1 is here. So ping pong, V2, V3, V4, V5, and my axis is too short. V5, and so on. Is it clear? That's the picture, approximate, of course, of the orbit of the point. So it goes to the right, and alternatively, positive ordinate, negative ordinate, positive, negative, positive, negative. Okay? And you could do the same for every point on the plane. So this is the shape of the orbit of the point. A little break on this, a little break on this. So what we are trying to do now is to conceive a method of compute an approximate value of square root of 2 with the help of an appropriate dynamical system. Which means that I'm going to write a matrix, which is another one, and by considering the action of this matrix on the plane as a dynamical system, that is, trying to understand how the points are moved by this transformation, we see that we can approximate the value of square root of 2. So that's interesting from my point of view. I mean, not only you prove that this is an irrational number, but moreover, we will be able to give approximate values as precise as we want, just by acting the dynamical system again and again and again. So let me write a matrix for that. So now, computation of square root of 2. Consider the matrix. Consider the matrix B for a change. Which is the following one. 1, 1, 2, 1. So simple matrix, the coefficients are integer numbers, integers, okay? So very similar to the matrix we considered before, the matrix A of yesterday, instead that we don't have the minus signs on the diagonal. I don't know your degree of familiarity with the notion of matrix. This one is the inverse of the matrix A of yesterday. So B is A minus 1 raised to the power minus 1, which means that the product BA is the identity matrix 1, 0, 0, 1. I leave you that as a simple exercise. Okay? So somehow, the matrix B being the inverse of the matrix A, it means that the action of B as a dynamical system will be the opposite as the action of A, which means that, for example, if a point and the orbit of a point is attracted by zero under the action of A, it will be repelled to infinity by the action of B, and so on. Okay, so in particular, you remember that we had some special vectors, what I call special vectors for A. the vector square root of 2, 1. I claim, and I am going to prove, that we have the same special vectors for B, exactly the same one. So the direction, the special direction, will be the same. So let's try to prove it. So first thing, I claim that the vector V1, which is equal to square root of 2, 1, is a special vector for B. Let me recall that by special vector, I mean the vector such that when you multiply V1 by the matrix A, you obtain a vector which is collinear, parallel to V1, which is a very special feature. So let's do the computation. B multiplied by V1, so equals 1, 2, 1, 1, multiplied by the vector square root of 2 and 1, and we get, once again, the classical thing, square root of 2 plus 2, and here square root of 2, no, square root of 2 plus 2, yes, and square root of 2 plus 1. So here, on the first row, I factor out square root of 2, and I get square root of 2 factor of 1 plus square root of 2. And the second line, I don't change. Square root of 2 plus 1. So elementary computation, which means that you can factor out of the vector square root of 2 plus 1. So here you obtain the number square root of 2 plus 1 multiplied by square root of 2, 1. That is square root of 2 plus 1 multiplied by V1. That's exactly what I call a special vector. The action of the dynamical system consists simply I multiply V1 by the number square root of 2 plus 1. Notice that this number, square root of 2 plus 1, is a positive number bigger than 1. In the spirit of the little example I gave here. Now, I claim that there is a second special vector. I claim that the vector W1 equals to minus square root of 2, 1. I claim that this vector is another special vector. Is another special vector. That is, once again, when I apply the matrix A multiplied to this vector, I obtain another vector which is parallel to this one. So let's do this computation to check this claim here. So once again, I compute, it's B, the matrix B. B multiplied by W1. Did I write A before here? No, this is correct. So what do I get? The matrix B is 1, 2, 1, 1, multiplied by W1, which is the vector minus square root of 2, 1. So what do I get? I get minus square root of 2 plus 2, and minus square root of 2 plus 1. Once again, on the first coordinate here, I factor out square root of 2. What I do get is the following. Square root of 2, factor of minus 1 plus square root of 2. And here, minus square root of 2 plus 1. Is it correct? Yeah. So let me go ahead in the equalities. Correct me if I do make some mistakes on the board. It might happen. So I obtain the number 1 minus square root of 2 multiplied by minus square root of 2 and 1. That is 1 minus square root of 2 multiplied by W1. Okay, always the same kind of computations, nothing hard here. No objection in the computation? So, notice here that, so let me write it in color, it will be important in the following. Here, this number here is bigger than 1, And this number here is 1 minus square root of 2, which is something like minus 0.4. Yeah, exactly. So this one is negative. And it is the opposite of a number between 0 and 1. So this, the opposite of a real number, of course positive, between contained in the interval 0, 1. So this is the open interval. So the situation here is very similar to the one we had here. Here the matrix, I wrote a diagonal matrix with the numbers 2 and, I forgot, minus, what was it here? Minus something,
1 over 3.
1 over 3, thank you. Minus. Yes, exactly. So 2 is bigger than 1 and minus 1 over 3 is the opposite of a number in, contained in the interval 0, 1. So let me draw the picture here. Or here, let me take some room. As usual, I draw the classical coordinate system. And let me draw the special directions. We have two special directions here. The first one corresponds to the vector v1. So once again, this vector is something like 1.4 here and here. So the first special direction is this line here. So it is directed by v1. Okay? So when a vector belongs to this line, the action of the matrix B consists by in multiplying this vector by the number square root of 2 plus 1, which is a number greater than 1. But we have now a second special direction, which is given by the number minus square root of 2, 1. So minus square root of 2 is here. And we obtain the second special direction here. So this one is directed by the vector w1. Okay? So, on the first special line, the action of the dynamical system consists in pushing away to infinity the points of the first line. On the second line, the action is the opposite, that is, contraction, because you multiply by a number which is between 0 and 1, with the ping-pong thing, because of the sign. If you remember my ping-pong story there, the same thing is going to happen because the sign of this number here is negative. So the shape and the behavior of the dynamical system I am going to get here is exactly the same as here, except that the picture has been rotated. So to understand what's happening here, we just have to keep in mind what happened here and rotate the picture. So the idea is rotate the situation. No, rotate is not exactly a rotation, but you see what I mean. The situation we had for the matrix 2, 0, 0, 1, minus 1/3. Okay, so what do I mean? Let me use the color here. The vector v1 corresponds to the number 1 plus square root of 2, which is bigger than 1. So the direction v1 here corresponds to this horizontal direction here, which is given by the number 2 here. So here, this one corresponds to to the horizontal axis in the case 2, 0, 0, -1/3. And of course, the other special direction will correspond to the vertical axis of this picture. So now let me consider a point, whatever it is, here. So a point with coordinate x0, y0. Can you deduce from the description we did here the behavior of the orbit of this point under the action of B? So let me remind you what was happening here. We started from a point there, then ping-pong from a side to another side of the horizontal axis, closer and closer to the horizontal axis, and going to infinity in the direction of the horizontal axis. The same thing is going to happen here, which means I start here, I will do a ping-pong between the direction v1, not between, but from one side to another of the direction v1, closer and closer to v1, and I go to infinity. So let me try to draw this slowly. First point here, so let me call it m0. Second point here, m1. So the red points here is the orbit of the point m0. And then ping-pong again, m2. But ping-pong closer and closer to this axis. And again, m3. And I go, I'm going to be too small to do this picture now, because it's very, very high for me. And again, we have two. My axis is too short. So this is M4. And the last one, just for the fun, M5. Do you understand the behavior? So ping-pong from one side to another of the direction V1, closer and closer to the direction V1, and you go to infinity. Okay. I claim that from this picture, we can compute square root of 2. Why? Because you might note something here. Let me draw for once. I prefer to draw points because it doesn't fill the picture. But for once, let me draw one vector. That is, instead of the point m2, for example, let me draw the vector from 0 to m2. Do you understand the behavior of the vectors when you follow the orbit here? The vectors are going to go one side to another of the direction v1, closer and closer, and very long and very long. So the length of this vector goes to infinity. So the slope of the vectors in the orbit, the red orbit here, are closer and closer to the slope of the direction v1. The length of the vector do not interest me because they go to infinity. They explode in this action. But what is interesting is the slope of these vectors. So let me write this sentence. The slopes of the vectors mn go to the slope of the direction v1. That is this direction here. Okay? Another way to say more or less the same thing is if I write Mn equals to the couple of coordinates xn, yn. So these are the coordinates of the point Mn here, for example. You have the following thing. Then the quotient xn divided by yn goes to the similar quotient for v1, the quotient of the abscisse divided by the ordinate. So what is the similar quotient for v1? Remember the definition of v1. V1 was the vector square root of 2, 1. So now you are probably getting what's going to happen here. It goes to square root of 2 divided by 1 when n goes to infinity. So the quotient of the coordinate of this point in this orbit as limit point square root of 2 goes to square root of 2 when n goes to infinity. So this is the consequence of the action of this dynamical system. So if you are able to have an orbit of points simple, then you will approximate square root of 2 closer and closer by a sequence of simple points, simple numbers. This is exactly what we are going to do. Suppose, for example, take M0, which is, for example, the vector of the point 1, 0. So now I am going to follow my notes. Because I already have the computations here. So we start with this. So M1 is the matrix B multiplied by 1, 0. What is B? Is the matrix there, where it is written on this board. So if you multiply it by 1, 0, you obtain the column 1, 1. So this is the coordinate of the second point of the orbit. And you do it again and again and again. So all these points will have integer coordinates. Let me write a few of them. The second one, M2, which is B multiplied by the previous one, 1, 1, is nothing but 3, 2. And you go, so you can compute it by hand or with the help of a computer. Notice that it is very easy because all the coordinates of these points are integers. Okay, so if I have M0, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, if I am correct, M14 is 1, 1, 4, 2, 4, 3, and 8, 0, 7, 8, 2. And we could go ahead and hand the computations are not complicated. So now we can compute the quotient x 14, sorry, divided by y 14, and we obtain, so blah, 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 and exercise. You take your best computer and you compute this. I don't have it here, but everybody can compute that. I will let you check that actually this number there is very close to the classical square root of 2 that you know. So here, it is not important that I write this on the board, you understand what's happening. This one, I claim, is very close to square root of 2. And if you go further and further in the action of the dynamical system, your sequence of points will have the quotient xn divided by yn closer and closer to square root of 2. Okay, so this is typically a classical thing that is using dynamical system to approximate irrational numbers, which are in general difficult to compute. You cannot write them exactly. As you know, they have an infinite, in general, decimal expansion, but you can here write a precise approximation obtained by simple computation with easy matrix. Okay, so this is what I have to say about square root of 2 and all this proof of irrationalities. So we have seen several of them. I guess that now everybody is convinced that square root of 2 is irrational. I mean, I gave 4 proofs for the price of 1, which is enough. So now we are going to start the second chapter of this course. And we are now in the heart of the topic, which is the notion of constructible numbers with ruler and compass. And we are going to start by the precise definition of these objects. And okay. So if I am correct, now is chapter 2. And chapter 2, I call it constructible objects. And I start this chapter by some basic definitions. Okay. So the main definition here is precisely the definition of what we call constructible objects, which are mainly points, lines, and circles. So I'm going to tell you what is a constructible point in the plane, line, or a circle. So definition. Definition, consider two distinct points O and I. We have to start with something, this contraction. So I suppose that in my pocket I have two points in the plane. I call them O and I. Okay? So it is very important to have distinct points here. In the plane, sorry, I didn't write it. In the plane. Okay, so now is the definition. So, first point, the points O and I are called constructible. First part of the definition. Second part, given two constructible points A and B, the line containing A and B, the line containing A and B is a constructible line. Okay. The third point of the this is the ruler or the straight edge. I am drawing the line between two points. Third object, the other tool, of course, the compass, given two points, A and B, two constructible points. A and B. Then the circle with center A and containing B is a constructible circle, So we are almost done with this definition. And finally, last point of this definition, for given two constructible lines or circles, so given two constructible lines or circles, the points belonging to the intersection of these two objects are constructible points. Is the definition clear? Maybe something you should notice in the last point. Here I have two constructible objects. So they can be two circles, two lines, or one circle and one line. So I intersect, for example, one circle and one line, I will get 2 points in general. These 2 points will be called constructible. So you see that it is a process which will be more and more complicated. You start with 2 points, O and I, and then you are going to add a lot of objects. Okay? Second section, basic construction. This section will be made essentially of exercise for you. This is, in general, elementary exercise. So I would like to know, I mean, not tomorrow, but because it's break, but maybe Friday, what kind of exercise you can do. So let me give you the list of classical exercise. First, given 2 points, A and B, construct the mediatrix of these 2 points. Okay, just with circles and lines, as we said. Given a line D and a point A, construct the orthogonal at D through A. Okay. Other exercise. Same thing with parallel. Same thing with parallel. Bisection of an angle. So that's interesting. So I will show you a picture of this exercise. Consider two lines, constructible lines, which intersect in a constructible point, A. We have the line D1 and the line D2. Okay? These lines are constructible, which means that they contain the points B here and the point C here, which are constructible. So there is an angle here. I want to construct a third line, which is the bisectrice of D1 and D2. So construct the bisectrice. It is called in general bisection of the angle. And finally, and we will stop here, last exercise of this list. Last exercise. Given a constructible square . The constructible square means a square whose vertices are constructible points. Okay? So given a constructible square, construct another square . This one is more interesting than the others. This one, you need to think a little more. Another square whose area is the double of the area of the first square. This exercise is called doubling the square. Is it clear? Okay, so we stop on this list on exercise. We will discuss them during next course, and you will see that some construction are much less evident than these ones. Okay. Thank you. Enough for today.